Hi, very good evening to everyone. I am Dr. Khyati Gidwani again. Today, continuing with the previous topic, today's topic is development of occlusion. That is the third part of the development series. So let's go ahead with our presentation. So what do we mean by occlusion? Occlusion of teeth is the key to normal oral function from birth until adulthood and beyond. The dental occlusion undergoes severe changes, and it is important for a clinician to understand what are these changes that we are. Yet there may be something that may be abnormal at one stage of life but may be normal at another stage of life. For example, the anterior deep bite, that is a transitioning in the primary dentition, end-on relationships, tendencies for before the loss of deciduous teeth. These are different things that are seen. So the literal meaning of occlusion is to close. And according to Angle, occlusion is the normal relation of the occlusal inclined planes on the teeth when the jaws are closed. So there are a number of definitions given by Bishara, by the American Association of Orthodontics. So definitions per se are not important, but the exact meaning of occlusion and what Angle said are definitely important. So classifying occlusion can be in the following stages. According to Barnett, he said that there is a first, second, third, fourth, and fifth stage. So first stage is 3 years of age, which is characteristically a primary dentition. The second stage is by 6 years of age, that basically marks the eruption of the first molar or the beginning of the permanent dentition. The third stage is 6 to 9 years of age, that is exchange of incisors are seen. As we go ahead, we see that this is the first transitory period. The fourth stage, that is 9 to 12 years of age, is exchange of the lateral teeth. And fifth stage, that is 12 years of age, is eruption of the second molars. This marks the end, just not considering the third molars, end of the permanent dentition. And the occlusion is stabilized by that time. Then classification by van der Linden gives a complete deciduous dentition, mixed dentition period, which is subclassified into first transition, intertransition, second transition period, and the permanent dentition. So as we've seen previously, the prenatal development, there are horseshoe shape or the catenary curve linings that are present, and each horseshoe shape lining has a number of bulbous bud-like structures, which are 10 upper and 10 lower. And we've gone through the stages in the previous seminar, the bud stage, cap stage, bell stage, advanced bell stage. So that is what is happening here. So, transverse development of both the jaws is mainly due to the median palatal suture of the maxilla and the symphysis of the mandible. Then going now postnatally. Postnatally, the first thing we see in children are gum pads that are seen developmentally. There is no teeth until 6 months or 6 to 8 months of age nowadays. So the gum pads are basically pink firm structures which are covered by a dense layer of fibrous periosteum. They have a number of grooves to demarcate where the successive primary teeth will come. The first is the dental groove that separates the labiobuccal portion and the lingual portion. The second is the transverse groove that is basically divides the gum pads into 10 segments consisting of each segment consisting of one developing tooth bud. The groove between the canine and the first molar is called as the lateral sulcus, and the gingival groove separates the gum pad from the palate and the floor of the mouth, corresponding to the uppers and lower jaw. So as we can see here, this is the transverse groove, the lateral groove, the dental groove, and the gingival groove. Relationship of the gum pad, as we have said, that there is a class 2 form of a pattern, and the gum pad is seen more prominent. The maxillary gum pad is more prominently positioned than the mandible. There is a complete over jet that is seen, and there is an anterior open bite. So all these features are physiologic. However, these features move on to the later stages of life, they do become pathologic in nature. The lack ventral sulcus of the mandibular arch is normally distal to the maxillary arch. The mandibular functional movements are mainly vertical and little anterior-posterior movement is seen. And the gum pads grow rapidly during the first year of life and growth is more in the transverse direction. The length increases mostly in the posterior direction. So like we spoke about self-correcting anomalies, that is the retrognathic mandible. So there is a class 2 form of a relation, which are more prominent maxilla. Anterior open bite is seen, eruption of the, which closes with eruption of the primary incisors. And there is an infantile swallow. So during suckling, basically the child has a swallow in which his tongue protrudes out between the gum pads. This kind of swallow is known as an infantile swallow. And as you start introducing solids into the diet, the child learns to swallow with the normal adult swallow, which is the tongue touching right behind the upper incisal area. Eruption of the primary teeth begins about 6 months of age. And all primary teeth are usually erupted by 2.5 years to maximum 3 years of age nowadays. At this stage, the roots of the second molar are usually not complete. Therefore, the establishment of primary dentition is usually considered by 3 years of age. Until 6 years of age, this dentition completely remains stable and the child is said to be in a primary dentition stage. So sequence of eruption, like we have seen previously, in last lecture, we saw a sequence of eruption. We saw eruption shedding stages. So the sequence of eruption for primary teeth is A, B, D, C, E. However, as we can see in this line, this gives the months. If you want, you can make a note of this. This is quite an important slide. So this gives the age in months. And the lower central incisors erupt first, then the upper central and lateral, followed by the lower lateral. The D's come out nearly simultaneously, C's come out nearly simultaneously. Then the lower dentition is first completed and then the upper dentition goes on to complete. So this was a schematic representation of what it was. Normal chronological, where we can see in Fuller's, Wheeler's, all our textbooks give us this. So this is the chronology of development of primary teeth with the months. So in four parts, that is first evidence of calcification, crown completion, eruption, and root completion. So going on to the primary dentition from the 6 month to 6 year of age, it has characteristically half round or horseshoe shape arches and with diastema present in the adjacent teeth. The mandibular teeth occlude lingually to the maxillary ones. The diastema mesial to the first deciduous molar between the latter and the second deciduous molar. Vertical overjet varies from 0 to 2 mm and in the anterior region. And the deciduous teeth are oriented perpendicular to the occlusal plane in mesiodistal and labiolingual directions. Same applies to the deciduous molars. The mandibular teeth occlude slightly mesially to the corresponding maxillary teeth. Spacing, Baum in 1950 divided the spacing as a dentition, as a space dentition or a non-space dentition. So first going on to the space dentition, we have a number of spaces, that is the primate spaces, physiologic spaces. The primate spaces are also known as simian spaces, primate spaces or anthropoid spaces. So this is quite important for us from an MCQ point of view, because in an MCQ, they may ask you about the space, but which name they will give is not really known. Sometimes an MCQ comes where they describe the space and ask you which space it is. So they may call it as the simian space of Baum or the primate space or anthropoid space, depends on what they wish to. So basically in and around the spaces is to be known. So in the maxillary arch, it exists between the deciduous lateral incisor and the deciduous canine. In the mandibular arch, it exists between the canine and the deciduous molar. This is about 1.7 and in the maxilla, and in the mandible it is 1.5. So importance of these spaces is that they produce a favorable alignment with the permanent incisors. Like we have seen last time in the differences between the primary and permanent teeth, there is a difference in the mesiodistal diameter. The permanent teeth have a greater mesiodistal diameter than the primary teeth. So the physiologic spaces that are present in the primary dentition helps recover the space and accommodation of the permanent dentition. The mean increase in intercanine width is brought about by the lateral frontal alveolar growth and is lesser in spaced arch than non-spaced arch. So there is no excessive spacing for erupting of the permanent incisors. So in a spaced dentition, the growth compensates and reduces, or in the non-spaced dentition, there is larger growth to accommodate the teeth. Physiologic spaces was given by Karkos. It's also called as developmental spaces by Faber. This is the space between all the primary teeth. If you must have noticed, primary teeth anteriorly and posteriorly do have some amount of spacings. They maximum the between the first and second molar, but they also have a contact area and not a contact point. This in the maxillary arch is 0 to 8 mm with an average of 4 mm depending on each child. In the mandibular arch, the total space present is 1 to 7 mm with an average of 3 mm. In a non-spaced dentition, it is tight. You cannot definitely say that a non-spaced dentition ends up in crowding, but mostly it does. And however, due to the growth factors, due to the increase in arch width, the intercanine width, sometimes growth catches up and accommodation of the permanent incisors or the permanent dentition is seen. So development of molar relationship is by this mechanism called as a cone and funnel mechanism, which states that the lower mandibular molar, the developmental groove acts as a cone and acts as a funnel, and the upper mesiolingual cusp of the upper maxillary molar acts as a cone. So this is intercuspated in the groove below, and that is the cone and funnel mechanism. Molar relationship is, there are three types of molar relationships that are seen. This is flush terminal plane, mesial step, distal step. So flush terminal plane is when this is basically described by the distal ends of the maxillary and mandibular second primary molars. So when the maxillary and mandibular second primary molars are in one plane, the distal surfaces, it's called as a flush terminal plane. This is the most favorable relationship, however, and it guides the permanent molars into a class 1 relationship mostly. So that's why it's a most favorable relationship. Then a mesial step is when the mandibular second molar is seen ahead of the maxillary second molar. Primary, this is all primary dentition. Okay. And this is also a favorable relationship. It may proceed into a class 1 relationship with later growth factors. However, it may go into a class 3 relationship if the growth is not favorable. Distal step is when the upper, the maxillary second molar is ahead of the mandibular second molar. There is a distal step formed with the distal surface, and it is mostly unfavorable, and this ends in a class 2 relationship maximum of the time. So the molar relationship on the emergence basically depends on the anterior posterior relationship of the two molars in the jaw before eruption, the relationship between the maxilla and the mandible in the sagittal plane, and the mesiodistal dimension ratio of the maxilla and mandible deciduous molars. Going on to the canine relationship, again dividing into class 1, class 2, class 3. Class 1 relation of the canine is the same, the maxillary primary tooth and the cusp tips, and is in the same plane, and the distal surface is the maxillary cusp tip is close to the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. The cusp tips of the maxillary primary canine tooth is mesial to the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. That describes a class 2 relation. And the maxillary primary canine tooth is distal to the distal surface of the mandibular primary canine. That is a class 3 relation. Anterior relation is basically of two types. That is over jet and over bite. Over jet is the horizontal overlap of the incisors. Over bite is the vertical overlap. Over bite is average of 2 mm. Over jet is also average of 0 to 4 mm. generally we say 2 mm of overjet and 2 mm of overbite are required. Then going on to the arch dimension, this was first described by Zsigmondy Palmer, and primary arches are basically ovoid in shape, and generally the interdental spaces decreases with age. However, both maxillary and mandible arches increase in width and grow posteriorly to accommodate the eruption of the permanent teeth. So arch width is between the primary canine and the primary second molars. Incremental of 0.5% or less is less than 20% of cases. So this is what we are seeing here. Between the primary canines and between the primary second molars, this is called as the arch width. Via this is called as the arch circumference. Between the distal surface of the primary second molar to the distal surface of the primary second molar, this is the arch circumference. So the width that we have seen here is called as the intercanine width. So it is of great importance and it will come later. Self-correcting anomalies that is seen in the primary dentition, like we saw in the pre-dentate stage, there are some self-correcting anomalies. So going on to the deciduous dentition, the self-correcting anomalies include a deep anterior deep bite, attrition which is compensated by attrition of the incisal edges, forward and downward movement of the growth of the mandible, and eruption of the permanent molars. Then trimid spaces, that is by early mesial shift, this page space closes. Flush terminal plane is by early mesial shift, that goes into a class 1 relationship. Late mesial shift, also it goes into a class 1 relationship, either ways. Physiologic spaces, when the permanent incisors come in, these physiologic spaces are used up. Mixed dentition period is basically classified into two kinds of periods, that is the first transition period and second transition period. First transition period is characterized by first permanent molars and transition eruption of the first permanent molars and transition of the incisors. The dentition, there is an intertransition period where the dentition is stable and goes on to the second transition period where the posterior teeth are exchanged, the canines are exchanged, and premolars do come into play. Second permanent molars mark the end of the second transition period. Okay. So going on to the first transition period, it is by 6 years of age. Both the jaws, the first permanent molars erupt, and the mesiodistal dimension of the maxilla is equal to the in the maxilla, the mesiodistal dimension of the mandible, and which is the mesial step. If the mesiodistal dimension of the crown of the maxilla is less than that of the mandible, it is a flush terminal plane. Ideally, the eruption of a permanent molar into a class 1 relationship is desired. Since the flush terminal relationship is more common in the deciduous dentition, it's more common for permanent molars to erupt in an end-on relationship. The desired class 1 can be established by the following, either early mesial shift or late mesial shift. So early mesial shift, like we spoke, is utilization of in the primary dentition, the space that is distal to the lateral canine or distal to the maxillary canine, which is the primate space, is utilized, and the moment the molars erupt, the whole dentition is pushed forwards. Late mesial shift is the dentition, the first molars erupt in an end-on relationship, and once they erupt, they stay like that until and unless the deciduous molars are exchanged for the premolars and leeway space of Nance is available. So with this leeway space of Nance, the permanent molars are pushed anteriorly, and this is what is known as the late mesial shift. Transition on the incisors, like we know that the incisors, permanent incisors, are greater in mesiodistal diameter. The four permanent incisors are greater in mesiodistal diameter than the deciduous incisors, and this difference in the diameters is called as incisal liability. In the maxilla, it is 7 mm. In the mandible, it is 5 mm. some of the factors that help in alignment of the incisors by gaining space is utilization of the interdental spaces in the primary incisors, average of about 4 mm in the maxillary arch and 3 mm in the mandibular arch, increase in intercanine width. So like I said, intercanine width is a very important factor and it compensates for a lot of changes that take place in the dentition. This occurs due to growth of jaws. Intercanine width increases markedly with eruption of the lateral incisors. In males, 6 mm for maxilla and 4 mm for mandible. In females, 4.5 mm for maxilla and 4 mm for mandible. So by the end of the 9th year in girls and 10th year in boys, the mandibular canine, which arch width dimension is essentially completed. In the maxilla, there is an anterior maxillary arch which increases in girls after 12 years of age. The difference in the age of the maxillary dimensions is due to the fact that pubertal growth spurt in girls is from 10 to 12, while in boys is for 12 to 18. Final horizontal growth increments in the mandible, particularly in males, cause the forward movement of the mandibular base with teeth. The basal changes eliminates any flush terminal plane tendencies that have persisted beyond the mixed dentition. But bodily mandibular thrust forward and unmatched by comparable maxillary horizontal growth changes. Hence, the maxillary intercanine dimensions serves as a safe value for the basal discrepancy. So going on to the intertransitional period, this period basically is a stable period for about 1.5 years of age between the first transition period and the second transition period. And there is varying of the deciduous teeth, which is seen, attrition of the cusp, small rotations may be seen, small pressure changes that are exerted by the tongue and lips. The second transition period is characterized by replacement of deciduous molars and canines by premolars and permanent canines respectively. And around 10 years of age, the deciduous canines are shed. But before the shedding, there is a transition or self-collecting malocclusion seen in the maxillary incisor between the age of 8 and 9. So as we spoke about leeway space of Nance, the mesiodistal dimension of the maxillary deciduous canine, first molar, second molar, and the mandibular canine, first molar, second molar, is less than that, is more than that of the permanent canine, first premolar and second premolar. So this difference in space that is seen in the maxilla and the mandible constitutes for the leeway space of Nance. In the maxilla, it is 0.9 mm per segment, which is 1.8 mm. In the mandible, it is 1.7 mm per segment, which is 3.4 mm. This is a very important MCQ. They can ask you about the concept of the leeway space of Nance, or they can ask you about the values of leeway space of Nance. Going on to ugly duckling phase, which is also known as Broadbent's phenomena. This is around the age of 8 to 9 years of age. There is a midline diastema seen, which is a typical features. There are flaring of incisors seen and the maxillary midline diastema. So a lot of parents come to the dentist saying that there's something wrong with my child's dentition. Does he need braces? But by 8 to 9 years of age, do not recommend that because the permanent canines are yet to come. And the permanent canines press onto the roots of the lateral incisor and the central incisor, which causes the midline diastema and the flaring. Once the permanent canines erupt into their position, the midline flaring decreases and stabilization is seen. So this phase is called as the ugly duckling phase. The second transition period, most common sequence of eruption of cuspids and bicuspids is in the maxilla is 4-3-5, in the mandible is 3-4-5. However, if the eruption sequence changes into 4-3-5 or 4-5-3 in the mandible, the leeway space of Nance is not being utilized efficiently. And in such cases, there may be a crowding of the dentition seen. However, intercanine width again may help in improving this. After eruption of the cuspids, bicuspids in the dental arch is established, the second molar begins to erupt. And the dental arch reduces just prior to the eruption of the second molar by the mesial forces. Therefore, it is possible that crowding will accentuate if it is already present. self-correcting developmental anomalies here are in the mandibular anterior crowding. So this is compensated by the primary primate spaces that were present, the intercanine width increase, and the tongue pressure. So in the lower mandible, there is a tongue pressure or a muscular pressure that is seen being exerted onto the lower anterior teeth that pushes it forwards and flattens and prevents crowding. Going on to the ugly duckling stage, this is corrected by, like we've seen, the emergence of the canine. Then end-on molar relationship of a permanent first molar is corrected by late mesial shift, if not early mesial shift. Going on to the permanent dentition, which forms within the jaw soon after birth, except the cusps of the permanent molars, which are before birth. The period is marked by eruption of the first four permanent second molars, and the sequence of eruption, like we've seen, 612345 or 612453. Okay. And the second molar is the last. So here, going back to the eruption table, again, this table is taken from a Wheeler's or Fuller's, whichever textbook you refer from. That is the upper dentition, that is the lower dentition. Going on to the British standard of classification, first we see the incisor relationship classification. This is nothing but another way to describe Angle's classification of class 1, 2, and 3. So, one, where does it stand with the Angle classification of class 1? That is, it occludes immediately plateau of the upper incisor, whereas in class 2 everything is more anteriorly placed, so the overjet increases with the so the lower incisal edge lies just posteriorly to the cingulum plateau of the upper central incisor. Now in this there is a division 1 and division 2, like we've seen in Angle's classification, div 1 and div 2. Div 1 is where the upper incisors are anteriorly placed, so there's an increase in overjet and upper central incisors are proclined. Then div 2 is the upper central incisors are flat while the laterals or the canines extrude out. So overjet is minimal. There is increase with retrocline upper incisors. The lower incisor edge, class 3, is the lower incisor edge lay anterior to the cingulum plateau of the upper incisor. So overjet is reduced or reversed. So like a normal class 3 relation. Going on to the canine relationship, when the mesial slope of the upper canine coincides with the distal slope of the lower canine, that is a class 1 relation. The mesial slope of the upper canine is ahead of the distal slope of the lower canine, again describing a normal Angle's class 2 relation. The mesial slope of the upper canine lies behind the distal slope, much behind, like maybe between the premolars of the lower canine. This is an Angle's class 3 classification. Going to curvatures of the tooth, first is curve of Spee, curve of Monson, which is more important. Curve of Spee is the when interdigitation of the teeth is seen, there is a slight curve that is seen anterior posteriorly. This curve is known as curve of Spee from the incisors to the molars. It's basically a slight curve, it's not a major curve. So the occlusal plane is, it may be the curve of Spee may be accentuated or maybe reversed or reduced. A flat curve of Spee is okay, acceptable. It should not exceed more than 1.5 mm in depth. And accentuated curve of Spee, where results when the upper teeth is seen in crowding and they extrude out. Reverse curve of Spee creates excessive space in the upper jaw because flaring of the teeth is seen. Going on to curve of Monson is basically the curve of occlusion in which each cusp and incisal edge touches to conform a segment of a sphere of 8 inches in diameter with its center in the region of the glabella. Then going on to Andrew's keys of occlusion, this is another important part and the last part for today. So he described the molar interarch relationship, mesiodistal crown angulations, labiolingual crown inclinations, absence of rotation, tight contact, and curve of Spee. So Andrew described these six keys of occlusion, and because apart from Engel's classification of malocclusion, he did notice a number of malocclusions still present. So that's why he divided them further. So molar relationship, like we know, the first molar relation should be the mesiobuccal cusp of the upper maxillary molar should lie in the mesiobuccal groove of the lower maxillary molar. So that is the ideal relationship. Mesiodistal angulations of the crown is the relationship of the long axis of the crown. The gingival part should be more distally placed as compared to the occlusal part. So plus reading is if the gingival portion of the long axis of the crown is distal, more distally than ideal. Minus reading is if the gingival portion of the crown is mesial than the incisal portion. Radiolingual angulation is if the gingival portion of the crown is basically for the upper and lower teeth, this is different. The gingival portion of the crown is lingually placed for the upper teeth as compared to the labial portion. While in the lower teeth, it is the labial portion that is labially placed and the gingival portion that is lingually placed. Going on to any rotations, some form of rotations, any rotation should not be seen because they are not ideal as compared to, as considered by Andrew. The contact points should be tight, absence of any abnormalities, any generalized spacing, any discrepancies. Occlusal plane, curve of spi, like we said, intercuspation, the curve of spi is defined. And Bennett and McLagan gave a seventh key of normal occlusion. You can take this down. This is normally not given in textbooks. It is Bennett and Lackthien who gave a seventh key of occlusion. That is, upper and lower tooth size should be correct. So if there is any discrepancy in the sizing of the tooth, that is also considered as a malocclusion. So concluding, it is important to supervise the dentition, especially as a periodontist. From each stage, each age describes a different form of dentition, different form of anomaly that is normal at that time. But if it persists into a different age, it becomes an abnormal finding. So just to get Andrew's keys of occlusion and Engel's occlusion concepts clear, I'll just show you one video and then we can completely dive into the MCQs.
Okay, so we've established that ideally, occlusion is important, but where do the teeth need to be to achieve an occlusion? To find out, we turn to two of the most inventive pioneers in orthodontics, Dr. Engel.
Is the audio audible? Is the audio of the video audible? Can you all hear? Is the audio audible of the video? Please reply someone, is the audio of the video audible?
Dr. Andrews.
I'm playing it. I'm increasing it a bit.
1855, Dr. Edward Engel is considered the father of modern orthodontics. He invented ingenious mechanical appliances for moving teeth and created the broad classifications of malocclusion that orthodontists still use today. Dr. Engel believed that the most fundamental characteristic of ideal occlusion was a proper molar relationship. He found that in patients with healthy bites, the mesiobuccal cusp of the first upper molar occludes in the buccal groove of the first lower molar. Dr. Engel called this ideal configuration a class 1 molar relationship. When lined up properly, the cusps of the upper molars mesh into the grooves in the lower molars like gears, so that the teeth can chew efficiently. If the mesiobuccal cusp of the upper first molar is anterior to this groove by the width of a premolar or more, is considered a class 2 molar relationship. If the upper cusp is posterior to this groove by the width of a premolar or more, it's called a class 3 molar relationship. Angle system can also be used to classify the canine relationship. In an ideal class 1 canine relationship, the distal slope of the upper canine coincides with the embrasure between the lower canine and first premolar. If the upper canine is significantly anterior to this embrasure, it's a class 2 canine relationship. If the upper canine is significantly posterior to this embrasure, it's a class 3 canine relationship. Angle system is very useful, but there are still many kinds of malocclusion that can't be summed up by a simple class number. In 1960, an orthodontist in San Diego named Lawrence Andrews grew frustrated with this imprecision. He reasoned that in order to accurately diagnose all various types of malocclusion, we would first need to identify and define the fundamental characteristics of ideal occlusion. Dr. Andrews began collecting study models for people with naturally ideal dentition. These people had never received orthodontic treatment, but their teeth looked straight and the bite was generally correct. Dr. Andrews measured and analyzed over 120 of these study models to discover the traits they held in common. Then he tested his findings by comparing them to over 1,000 study models of orthodontists across the country. After 12 years of research, he published his combined achievement in 1972, The Six Keys to Normal Occlusion. Andrews' six keys start with something familiar, inter-arch relationships. Teeth in ideal occlusion should have a class 1 molar and canine relationship, as described by Dr. Engel. Dr. Andrews also specified that the distal surface of the upper first molar's distobuccal cusp should occlude with the mesial surface of the lower second molar's mesiobuccal cusp. Andrews' second key is crown angulation, the mesial or distal angle of the crown. Some doctors refer to crown angulation as tip. This is the angle formed by the facial axis of the clinical crown and a line perpendicular to the occlusal plane from a facial perspective. Crown angulation is considered positive if the occlusal portion of the facial axis is medial to the gingival portion and negative if it's distal. In an ideal arch, all the crowns should be angled positively. In other words, the crowns should tilt medially from the gums. It's important to note that we're evaluating the facial axis of the clinical crown, not the long axis of the entire tooth. On all the teeth except molars, the facial axis is the most prominent portion of the central lobe on a crown's facial surface. On molars, the facial axis is the buccal groove that separates the two large facial cusps. The third key is crown inclination, the facial or lingual angle of the crown. This is the angle formed by the facial axis of the clinical crown and a line perpendicular to the occlusal plane from the mesial perspective. Crown inclination is considered positive if the occlusal portion of the facial axis is facial to the gingival portion, and negative if it's lingual. In an ideal arch, all of the crowns are inclined positively. In other words, the crowns should tilt facially from the gums. Crown inclination is sometimes incorrectly referred to as torque. Torque actually refers to the twisting force, which is traditionally required to adjust the inclination of the crown. Andrew's fourth key is rotations. This is an easy one. The teeth should be free of undesirable rotations. A rotated molar won't occlude properly and may occupy too much space in the arch. Andrew's fifth key is spaces. This is another simple one. You don't want spaces. Unless there's a genuine tooth size discrepancy, the contacts should be tight. And the final key is the curve of speed. This describes the curvature of the occlusal plane. The curve of speed should be flat or slightly concave. The deeply concave curve won't allow enough space in the upper teeth. The convex curve will spread them out too far. So to recap, Dr. Engel created a classification system for molar and canine relationships. Class 1 is the ideal relationship. The medial buccal cusp of the first upper molar occludes in the buccal groove of the first lower molar. The distal slope of the upper canine lines up with the embrasure between the lower. Two relationships into the other, to the interior, into the posterior, to the other orbit. Inter-arch relationship, molars and canines should be flat forward. Crown angulation should tilt medially. Crown inclination, crown should tilt patiently. There shouldn't be any rotations. There shouldn't be any spaces. And the curve of speed should be flat or slightly concave. Evaluating these aspects of your patient's occlusion can help you identify dental problems. And that's what we're going to discuss in our.
So I hope that was clear for development of occlusion. Now we'll go right into the MCQs of last time, that is development of dentition and development of occlusion together. So going on to the first MCQ, microdontia or macrodontia of teeth is because of damage of the tooth in which stage of development? The answer is C, morphodifferentiation. Extreme curvature of buccal side is a characteristic of which tooth? The answer is A, the mandibular first primary molar. They have an extreme curvature of the buccal side of the tooth. All of the following is true for primary teeth except the crowns of the primary teeth are wider in comparison to those crowns in the permanent teeth, which is false. The crowns in the permanent teeth have a greater mesiodistal diameter. The roots of the primary molars are longer and slender. They're not longer, but they definitely are slender. Let's go ahead. Primary teeth are usually lighter in color. Yeah, primary teeth are usually lighter in color. In they are somewhere longer and slender. Okay, the primary teeth are usually lighter in color than the dye in the permanent teeth, which is yes. The buccal curvature of the primary first molar is not as prominent. That is definitely false. Then, according to Moyer, the most favorable sequence of eruption in the maxillary teeth is 612-435, 612-345, 612-453. It's C. The answer is C. 612-453. Then the canine erupts last in the maxillary, but not in the mandibular. Primary teeth, which are most often ankylosed, are the mandibular second molar. Most ankyloses are seen in the mandibular second molar. Blunderbuss apex, this we have seen last time, is it is a wide open apex. A wide open apex is known as a blunderbuss apex. What age is the child expected to have 12 erupted primary teeth and 12 erupted permanent teeth? So this we are talking about a mixed dentition child. And the answer for this is 8 years of age. There is some printing mistake here, but it's 8 years of age. Which of the following is an abnormal sequence of the eruption of the primary permanent molar teeth? Abnormal sequence of eruption. The first molar erupts before the central incisor, which is true, which is a normal sequence. The second molar erupts before the second premolar. No, this is the abnormal eruption pattern. So the second molar erupts last after the premolars and the canines have been complete. According to universal system, the maxillary left first permanent molar is identified as. So as we go ahead, I will definitely show you the systems of tooth identification. And the universal system basically classifies from the upper right, the maxillary right quadrant, as the last molar as a 1. And goes on to the maxillary left, then goes on to the mandibular left, and goes on to the mandibular right. Ends as the 32 in the mandibular right. So here they are asking the maxillary left first permanent molar is classified as 14. The number is 14. Mamelons are seen in the permanent dentition, not in the primary dentition. We had seen this as a difference in the maxillary, in the primary and permanent dentition. There is presence and absence of mamelons. Supervision of the child's development of occlusion is most critical in the ages 3 to 6, 7 to 10, 11 to 14, 14 to 17. So the answer is 7 to 10 because maximum growth takes place during that time. The exchange of the dentition is seen during that time. If there is any space discrepancy, it can definitely be caught during that time. The premature exfoliation of the primary canine may indicate arch length excess, arch length deficiency, skeletal malocclusion, arch length excess more than 10. So there is a premature loss of a tooth. It's definitely not going to be an arch length excess. So the first and last option is out. The answer is between a skeletal and arch length deficiency, which it's not a skeletal issue because it's a dental issue. So the arch length deficiency is the answer. Eruption of the mandibular second permanent molar before the second premolar can cause arch length deficiency. It is desirable that the mandibular canine erupts before the first and second premolars. So in this, both the statements are completely true. It does cause a deficiency and it is desirable that the mandibular canines erupt before the first and second premolars. Like I had told you in the presentation also, the leeway space of Nance is not utilized properly if the mandibular canines do not erupt before the premolars. So it's not utilized in the most efficient way. So there is a degree of crowding that is seen. And moreover, before the eruption of the mandibular second molars, permanent second molars, there is a mesial shift of the dentition that is seen. So if there is a crowding at this stage, it accentuates if there is a more mesial shift. So that is why both the statements are true. All of the following are true regarding contact areas in primary teeth, except all are true except. So there is a broad contact area, which is true. A flatter contact area, which is true because there is a contact area and not a point like in a permanent dentition. It is situated more occlusally. No. Need to be broken in a class 2 cavity preparation, which is true. So the answer is C. It is not situated more occlusally. In the stage of this ends. So the last stage of tooth development is apposition, and that is what it is. In NOLA stages of tooth development, crown completion occurs by. So I had shown you a picture of NOLA stages of development. If you remember, there are 1 to 10 stages of NOLA stages of development. And crown completion occurs by the fourth stage. In 8-year-old patient, 8-year-old patient has maxillary permanent central incisor erupted to the extent that 2/3 of the anatomic crown may be seen clinically. At 3 mm diastema exists between these teeth. In such cases, the diastema may be as a result of a failure of fusion of the premaxilla, an abnormal labial frenum, a supernumerary tooth in the midline, or a normal eruption pattern. So like we had seen, anybody wants to try to answer this? This question has been seen in the presentation that we just saw. The answer to this is the ugly duckling stage that we had seen, and the answer is D. It is a normal eruption pattern. The ankylosis of teeth is generally observed after a change in the continuity of the occlusal plane. This change is caused by differential eruption sequence, ankylosed teeth sinking in the alveolar bone, localized growth inhibition of the alveolar process, continued eruption of non-ankylosed teeth, and growth of the alveolar process. So the answer is D. Both the factors contribute to sinking of the tooth, that is continuous growth of the non-ankle or eruption of the non-ankylosteep and growth of the alveolocrosis. Which of the following represents a normal relationship of primary canine? Distal inclined plane, we had seen the relationship class 1, 2, 3. So the answer is B. Mesial inclined plate of the maxillary canine articulates with the distal inclined plane of the mandibular canine. Predicting the adult occlusion, flush terminal plane in the maxillary dentition is considered to be normal, but it provides no guarantee for an ultimate molar relationship. The answer is E. In the absence of a permanent second molar, premolar, the roots, permanent second premolar, the roots of the primary second molar, which most likely show resorption as the initial force is absent, resorb more rapidly than normal, more slowly than normal, resorb at a normal rate. So we have seen in the previous presentation of eruption and shedding that there are two kinds of shedding of teeth and two kinds of resorption. One is successor, other is without a permanent successor. So this is without a permanent successor, and until the PDL fibers dissolve and resorption starts, it's going to definitely take more time and it's going to be slower than the normal resorption. Clinical examination of a 15-year-old girl reveals permanent central incisors, permanent canines anterior to the premolars. This suggests thumb sucking habit, ankylosed permanent primary molars, impacted teeth, congenitally missing permanent lateral incisors. So, like we have seen, that there is no lateral incisor in what they've counted. So, the answer is a congenital missing lateral incisor. When the tooth enamel mineralization complete, when does the tooth enamel mineralization complete? So the answer is B, at some time following eruption. So once the tooth has erupted, the enamel mineralization is not complete. So that is why it is most susceptible to caries when it's just erupted in the mouth. And once a couple of months after that, mineralization is complete. Which of the following situations is space maintenance most difficult to manage? 9.5-year-old patient with loss of permanent maxillary first molar. So at this point of time, the second maxillary molar, permanent molar, will come and drift in its place. So if the molar is extracted, so that's completely okay. The 5-year-old patient with loss of primary maxillary central incisor. Again, by the age of 7 years old, the maxillary central incisors also to come out. So this is not a big deal. 6-year-old patient with loss of permanent primary mandibular first molar. Again, not a big deal. A normal space maintainer can be placed here. A band and loop space maintainer. 7-year-old patient with loss of maxillary second molar. So post, this is assuming the patient has the correct dental age. A 7-year-old patient will have an erupted first molar permanent. So the space should be maintained with a normal space maintainer like a band and loop. A 5-year-old patient with loss of mandibular second molar. So this is a tricky situation because the primary mandibular second molar generally guides the eruption of the permanent mandibular first molar, because at 6 years of age, the permanent mandibular first molar erupts. So we need to place a distal shoe space maintainer, but again, it depends on the efficiency of the space maintainer that the space is maintained, and post the eruption, again, the distal shoe is to be changed to passive space maintainer. The last primary tooth to be replaced by a permanent tooth is usually, the answer is B, a maxillary canine. The interval between crown completion and the beginning of eruption until the tooth is in full occlusion of permanent teeth is approximately 5 years. The answer is D. round completion and beginning of eruption of the tooth in full occlusion is D. Preservation of the primary dentition will always prevent a malocclusion. Early loss of primary molar causes more severe effects than early loss of primary incisors. So the first statement is false. That is, preservation of a primary dentition will always prevent a malocclusion. That is not true. There may be some growth patterns that change. You cannot always say it will happen. And the second statement is definitely true. So the answer is A. Disturbances in morpho differentiation stage of the tooth germ results in morpho differentiation. Basically, is the shape and size of the tooth being determined in that stage. So the answer is B, that is abnormal form and size of the teeth is seen. Except the latency period between exfoliation of deciduous teeth and eruption of succedaneous permanent teeth, except the latency period between exfoliation of the deciduous teeth and eruption of the succedaneous teeth is 6 months. If the tooth has been extracted or lost, and in the next 6 months you see a succedaneous teeth, that's fine. If there is delay, then you have to take a radiograph and investigate why is there a delay. The most frequently impacted permanent tooth is the mandibular. Frequently impacted permanent tooth is actually the maxillary canine, because that comes out last. So there may be space or there may not be space for it. That is a question. So if there isn't much space for it, the tooth seems to be impacted. A primary second molar becomes ankylosed most commonly during root formation, during physiologic root resorption, during failure of the alveolar bone tooth to go, or all of the above. The answer is B, during physiologic root resorption. So the tooth remains the way it is, but when the other teeth are resorbing, that is when we find out that the physiologic resorption for the tooth is not happening. So that is why it is ankylosed. Extraction of the upper first molar may be indicated when the only reason to extract a molar if the prognosis is very poor, the molar has been broken down due to any form of caries up to the root level and you cannot save it under any circumstances, that is when you go and extract a permanent first molar. Mesial drift of a permanent mandibular first molar after premature extraction of the primary mandibular second molar is an example of. The answer is B, to physiologic tooth movement. So like we had seen, there are post-eruptive phases also of tooth movement. So this is one of that case, that after the tooth has erupted, there is a premature loss of a deciduous tooth. So the permanent tooth goes in its place. Apart from the permanent third molars, the most commonly missing permanent tooth is the mandibular second premolars. That is the answer. The mandibular second premolars are the most commonly missing ones. Distal step relationship of a second primary molar is indicative of, we just saw it in the presentation, it is indicative of a class 2 malocclusion, because the lower deciduous second molar is placed more distally than the upper. So it causes the distal surfaces of the upper and the lower molars do form a distal step. The incipient proximal decalcification in the primary molars can first be seen in the radiograph. At the point of contact, just gingival to the point of contact, just occlusal to the point of contact, or none of the above. So the answer to this is just gingival to the point of contact, because the point of contact that is present causes food lodgement just gingival to that, and you cannot clean that area very easily. So that is why it causes decalcification, and that is the point of starting of caries. Which of the following statements regarding primary enamel hypoplasia is true? Hypoplasia of primary enamel that forms before birth is rare. It is common in prematurely born, very low birth rate. children. If ameloblastic activity is disrupted for a long time, gross areas of irregular enamel occur, disrupted for a short time. It manifests as a thin line or a pit. The answer is D, all of the above are true. Dental arch circumference reduces during primary dentition, late transition, permanent dentition. Arch circumference reduces during late transition as well as during permanent dentition because it is seen that there is a mesial shift of the teeth that are seen before the second molars, permanent molars erupt. So the answer is both B and C. Most class 2 malocclusions can be prevented by maintaining integrity of primary teeth, preventing deleterious habits like thumb sucking, lip biting, breastfeeding, no known techniques. So the answer, or the last one is A, B, and C. So the answer is definitely A and definitely B. You have to maintain the integrity of the primary teeth. That doesn't say that always there are no malocclusion, but most of the time malocclusions can be prevented. So A, preventing any form of habits is definitely a way to prevent malocclusions. And C is there is no exact known technique. So yes, the answer is D, which is A, B, and C. Following the loss of permanent mandibular first molar at the age of 8, one could expect which of the following changes to occur in the quadrant over a period of time. So the permanent mandibular first molar is lost at the age of 8. It came out at the age of 6 and is lost at the age of 8. Which of the following changes to occur in the quadrant over a period of time? So for a long period of time until the second permanent mandibular molar erupts, there is a big space. So what is going to be seen is the distal shift of the second premolar and the mesial drift of the second. Okay. Oblique ridge is formed by union of. So the answer to this is known from our dental anatomy. That is the mesiopalatal cusp of the maxillary first molar and the retrobuccal cusp. So the oblique ridge is seen in the permanent maxillary first molars or the primary maxillary second molars. Variation in the time of eruption of the primary teeth and in the time of exfoliation is frequently observed in pediatric patients. How much of the variation in time of exfoliation of the primary teeth is considered normal? So here they're asking a different question as compared to the previous one. Variation in the time of exfoliation, they're asking, which is considered normal, means after that you have to go checking. So the answer is B, 18 months. Assessment of crowding in the mixed dentition can be done by observing the erupting permanent incisors, radiographic examination, mixed dentition analysis, all of the above. The answer is all of the above. You can observe clinically the dentition that is coming out. You can have a radiographic examination or you can make casts and make a mixed dentition analysis. Spaces between the anterior primary teeth are anterior primary teeth. So like we had seen, the normal abnormalities that are present in the dentition, in the primary teeth are spaces between the teeth. So it is common. Yes, it is commonly seen and it is desirable. So the answer is C, common and desirable. A 10-year-old patient has a cusp-to-cusp molar relationship in a mixed dentition. This will probably become a class 1 molar relation by the maxillary molar drift 9 mm posteriorly, the mandibular molar drift 4 mm forward, both the molars drifting forward with the mandibular molar drifting about twice as far as the maxillary molar, or an orthodontic intervention. But I think the answer is C. Both the molars need to drift forward, obviously, because they need to come into that arch length. And to get a cusp, from a cusp-to-cusp relation to go into a class 1 relation, the mandibular molar has to drift about a cusp forward, so twice as far as the maxillary molar. An unerupted premolar usually takes months to travel through 1 mm of bone. How many months? So the answer is ideally 6 months, or you can say in a range 4 to 6 months. So the closest answer to this is 4 to 5 months. So that is the answer C. Primate spaces are otherwise called, this was even during the presentation, I had stressed upon this, that it is an important question that comes. Alternate names, describing the spaces, why are they present, where are they present. So primate spaces are otherwise called simian spaces, primate spaces of Baum, anthropoid spaces. The answer is D, all of the above. What is the cause of midline diastema? Supernumerary teeth, high frenal attachment, mesiodense. So mesiodense is a supernumerary tooth that is present. High frenal attachment, yes. So the answer is D, all of the above. In a normal child, the teeth that are generally in process of calcification at birth are. So again, the chart that is there in Wheeler's, Fuller's has to be noted. The answer is B. All the primary teeth definitely are in the process of calcification, and the first permanent molars start calcification. The first evidence of calcification is at birth. So that is what the answer is B. The first permanent molars and all primary teeth. Radiograph of a 5-year-old child shows permanent maxillary first molar inclined mesially with resulting resorption of the distal portion of the roots of the primary second molar. This condition is definitely not ectopic eruption. Yes, by a resorption from the pulp chamber. Ankylosis is when the tooth is seen submerged. Ectopic eruption is a tooth that is erupting in a space that is there, which it is not supposed to be erupting in, or erupting ectopically, not in its position. So that is the answer. And the third, last one is premature eruption. No, they did not specify anything of the time. It is observed that loss of the primary molar before the age of 7 years will lead to delayed eruption of a 1 minute. I think there is a connectivity error. Please give me 1 minute. I will just reset the connection. We can take this question till then. It is observed that loss of the primary molar before the age of 7 years will lead to delayed eruption of the succedaneous tooth, whereas loss of after 7 years will lead to an early emergence of the succedaneous tooth. So the answer is A. Both the statements are definitely true. If the tooth is lost before 7 years of age, the succedaneous tooth is delayed, while if it's lost after 7 years of age, it speeds up the succedaneous tooth being erupted. Periodontics involves treatment of patients up to 15, up to 12, up to 18, up to 16. So as we have seen, the dentition stabilizes with the post-eruptive changes also by the age of 15. So we see patients up to the age of 15. The slide is not changing, right? Give me a minute. 1 minute. Please give me a minute. Hello, yeah, hi. Actually, it is, this thing is, my slides are not going ahead. Are you there or Mr. Rajesh said you will be there now? Yes, so you log in, I will just... Hi.
Yeah.
Okay. I will just share the screen. Give me 1 minute. That's the MCQ we were on. The anterior teeth of both dentitions serve for growth and development of the jaws, are not important psychological factors for well-being of the individual, are a primary factor in psychological well-being, serve only for incision. So the answer is C, because anterior teeth, the most important function is primary factor, is a psychological factor and aesthetics. Whether it is the primary dentition or the permanent dentition, the answer is the same. Ugly duckling stage of the dentition in a child is corrected by eruption of which tooth? So we have seen this in our previous presentation. The answer is canine C. Eruption of the canine. The canine is the tooth that comes out last in the maxillary arch. And that is what imposes pressure on the roots of the lateral and central incisors. And due to that, there is the ugly duckling stage, that is flaring of the incisors with a midline diastema that is seen. And once the tooth erupts, all the features are dissolved. Effect of premature loss of tooth in a child is change in occlusion, development of an abnormal habit, disturbed phonetics. So this is a very wide area. Definitely the occlusion changes with premature loss of a tooth. Definitely there are abnormal oral habits that are seen. That is, if the lateral teeth are lost, it causes a lateral tongue thrust. There is definitely a change in phonetics that are seen. If the anterior teeth are lost, the child develops a lisp. Whistling sounds are seen. So the answer is all of the above. The crown of all permanent teeth, with an exception of the third molars, are calcified by the age of, the answer is B, 8 years. Calcification of all happens except the third molars by the age of 8 years. The average age of which calcification of crowns of the permanent incisor is completed by? Calcification of crowns of the permanent central incisors. The answer is C, 4 to 5 years. So this all comes from the table in Wheeler's or Fuller's. And this table, basically the central incisors, the molars, the first evidence of calcification, crown completion, root completion, and eruption, all four ages are to be remembered. Ectodermal cells are responsible for pulp, cementum, periodontal tissue, determination of shape of the tooth. So from the ectodermal cells, the bud stage starts. From the bud, and even the condensation of the cells around the bud are ectomesenchymal in origin. So the ectodermal cells are basically involved for the whole formation of the tooth. So all the points are there. But so the last option, determining the shape and size of the crown and root, encompasses all the factors. So that is the answer D. So I'm just showing you the table again once. This is of the primary dentition, the upper and lower teeth, the first evidence of calcification, crown completion, eruption, and root formation need to be remembered basically for the incisors. For the deciduous, you can do it for the incisors and the canine, like the central incisor, the canine, and the second molar. Similarly, central incisor, canine, and second molar. For the permanent dentition, you can do the central incisor, the canine, the first molar, and the first premolar. First premolar also is hardly asked, but the central incisor, canine, and molars are definitely asked of the upper and the lower dentition. Average leeway space in an individual is, we have seen this, the answer is 9 mm in the mandible and 7 mm in the maxilla. The premature loss of primary mandibular canine is most often the sequel of which of the following? So premature exfoliation of the mandibular canine. So all the teeth, the premature loss or premature exfoliation is generally attributed to caries. However, for the canines, they are not very susceptible to caries because they are known as the cornerstone of the tooth. And due to being the cornerstone of the tooth, they are very well cleaned. So the answer is arch length deficiency or arch length inadequacy. In this case, yes, there is premature loss of the canine. Dental lamina formation begins by, the answer is 6 weeks. 6 weeks of interuteline life, the first evidence is seen. In the average child, teeth generally in the process of calcification at birth are all the primary teeth, definitely, and the first permanent molars. Like I said, the first evidence of calcification of the first permanent molars are seen at birth. The name of the space between the lateral incisor and the canine in the maxillary deciduous teeth are freeway space. Lateral incisor and canine is in the maxillary deciduous are freeway space. Primate spaces. Then tooth buds generally initiated after birth are the first and second premolars. Those are initiated, even the tooth bud, forget the first evidence of calcification, even initiation of the tooth bud happens after birth in the first and second premolars, the first and second premolars and the second and third molars. If the distal surface of the maxillary second molar is distal to the mandibular second primary molar, it depicts what kind of a relationship? The answer is B, mesial stem. The ectopic or delayed eruption in the anterior segment of the arch is caused by ectopic or delayed eruption in the anterior segment. Presence of a supernumerary tooth, yes, maybe. Migration of teeth, maybe. Premature loss of primary teeth, maybe. Discrepancy between size of teeth and size of arch, maybe. Unfavorable sequence of eruption, maybe. So the answer is all of the above. Extraction of deciduous incisors needs a space maintainer, enhances possibility of protrusion, does not have any effect on the developing permanent teeth, or none of the above. So one fact about the deciduous incisors is that even after you extract them, they do not see as much space loss as is seen in the posterior dentition, because as the child grows, there is an increase in the intercanine width, and the incisors that are placed anteriorly to the canines, generally, if they are extracted, they do not see any effect on the developing permanent dentition. 10-year-old patient shows a discrepancy in the midline of the maxillary and the mandibular occlusion. This may result of severe close bite condition, class 2 division 1 malocclusion, deviation of the mandible on closure, lateral rift of the maxillary or mandibular anterior teeth. So they have not specified that what kind of a discrepancy is it? Is it a dental discrepancy or a skeletal discrepancy? So we cannot make assumptions. So if there is a deviation in the mandible on closure, it becomes a skeletal discrepancy, which is a possibility. If there is a lateral drift of the maxillary or mandibular anterior teeth, it becomes a dental discrepancy, which is a possibility. So the answer is D, C or, I mean, the answer is E, which is C or D. Extraction of the deciduous incisors, again, like I spoke previously, it does not have any effect on the developing permanent teeth. In a 10-year-old patient that shows discrepancy, okay. A premature exfoliation of the primary canine may indicate premature exfoliation of the primary canine. We have discussed that a primary canine is lost due to arch length discrepancy only. The mechanism of tooth eruption is best explained on the basis of hormonal mechanism is not explained. Primary tooth exfoliation, not really. Programmed cell death, basis of the crypt, at the base of the crypt, not really. Osteoclastic activity at the base of the clip, not really. That's just a part of what happens totally. Proliferation of the clip, yes, that is what helps. After eruption of the permanent tooth, the time required for a pipe closure of its root is approximately 4.5 to 5.5 years, 2.5 to 3.5 years, 1.5 to 2.5 years, none of the above. So the options are quite close. 4.5 to 5.5 is completely out of the picture because it's too long. So if we see, the answer is either 2 to 3 years or 2.5 to 3.5 years. So that's what is the relevant answer will be 3.5 years, that is B. Among the primary teeth, the problem of ankylosis is most commonly seen, and we have seen this earlier. The answer is mandibular molars, and the answer is mandibular second molars to be more precise. 7-year-old child shows premature loss of primary mandibular canines. He has no caries in his remaining teeth. The situation strongly suggests insufficient arch length. The answer is C. Mandibular canines, loss of primary canines are due to insufficient arch length. The sum of widths of primary first and second molars is generally the same as that of the permanent successor. 1 or 2 mm greater than the permanent successor, 1 or 2 mm lesser than the permanent successor, or 8 mm lesser than the permanent successor. So the answer is the leeway space of Nance, which gives this space, and the answer is B, 1 or 2 mm greater than the permanent successor. All of the following are true regarding ankylosed teeth, except it usually occurs in the primary molar region. It does. Ankylosed teeth are otherwise called as submerged teeth. Yes. If ankylosis occurs early, the involved tooth may lie below the plane of occlusion. Yes, that's the reason why they are called submerged teeth. Ankylosis always occurs after eruption of the tooth into the oral cavity. Not necessarily. So the answer is D. With the eruption of which teeth do maxillary anterior diastemas normally close? Again, they are referring to the ugly duckling stage. So the answer is A. With the eruption of canine, the diastema closes. Riga fede disease is characterized by natal teeth with tongue ulcerations, eruption of hematoma, natal teeth with eruption cyst or Epstein-Pearls. The answer is A. Ulcerations are seen on the ventral portion of the tongue because of the suckling action. So in the suckling action or the infantile swallow, the tongue is protruded between the upper and lower arch, as we have seen. So generally, if there are gum pads, there is no problem. However, if there are teeth present in the mandible, so ulcerations are seen on the ventral surface of the tongue. And this whole scenario is called as a Riga fede disease. Permanent teeth begin their eruption to the oral cavity when 3/4 of the roots are complete. The answer is C. How much of incisor liability is found in the maxillary arch? 7 mm. We have spoken about this. Enamel hypoplasia is because of disturbance in which stage? So even while explaining the stages, I had described the disturbances in each stage. So enamel hypoplasia is actually lack of calcification during deposition. So that happens in apposition, last stage. They are hypocalcified structures basically. In the primary teeth, the cusp of Caraballi is seen in the maxillary first molar, second molar, mandibular first molar, second molar. So in a hurry, someone may just mark it as maxillary first molar because that is what we've always associated a cusp of Caraballi with. But the cusp of caraboli is the extra cusp that is seen on the middle cusp of the molar. And this is seen in the primary dentition in the maxillary second molar, while in the permanent dentition in the maxillary first molar. So the answer is B, maxillary second molar. The primary second molar, that is the mandibular molar, resembles which tooth? The primary second molar. So all the teeth have their resemblance to the permanent dentition, the primary teeth. The maxillary first primary molar resembles the premolar. The maxillary second primary molar resembles the permanent maxillary first molar. The mandibular first primary molar does not resemble any tooth in the arch. And the primary mandibular second molar resembles the permanent mandibular first molar. So the answer is B, permanent mandibular first molar. Clinical emergence of the tooth occurs when 3/4 of the root is complete. C. The most favorable eruption sequence for the mandibular permanent dentition, we have spoken about this. The answer is A, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So if the premolars erupt earlier to the canine, there is not best usage of the leeway space of Nance. Hence, the premolars are to erupt after the canine. In examining the primary dentition, if it is observed that lateral incisor is congenitally missing, what is most likely to happen? The permanent canine will be missing? No. The permanent lateral incisor will also be missing? Yes, that is what happens. Because we've seen that the permanent teeth come out from succedaneous lamina, which is present, which is an extension of the dental lamina. So if the first tooth bud is missing, definitely the second tooth bud is not going to be present. So the permanent lateral incisor will also be missing. Which of the following regarding teething is true? So we have discussed teething last time in eruption and shedding. So it is associated with increased salivation. Yes, siluria, drooling is seen in children. The child puts hand and finger into the mouth. Yes, they chew on their fingers so as to relieve the pressure. Diarrhea and fever are incorrectly attributed to teething. Yes. They are, but it does happen during teething because the child chews on different substances and there may be different microorganisms that enter the digestive system, and that is why they get diarrhea and fever at times. So the answer is D, all of the above. It's not precisely due to teething, but it is a sequelae of it. The congenital absence of tooth is attributable to which stage in tooth development? Initiation, proliferation, histodifferentiation, morphodifferentiation, apposition. So we are talking about congenital absence of the tooth itself. Matlab, there is no tooth, but there is nothing. So the answer is A, initiation and proliferation, there is nothing at congenital absence. I have told previously the answer is mandibular first molar. According to universal system, the maxillary left second primary teeth, primary molar is identified as B. The answer is K. In FDI of dental recording, which of the following is true? The first digit indicates quadrant, the second digit indicates the type of tooth in the quadrant. Quadrants are allotted in the digits 1 to 4 in permanent and 5 to 8 in the primary dentition in clockwise sequence starting from upper right side. The teeth within the same quadrant are allotted to the digits in 1 to 8 from the midline backwards. This is known as two-digit system. The digits should be pronounced separately. The answer is E, all of the above. The whole thing basically describes the FDI system. So I will just show you once. This is the FDI system, which goes from 1-1, 2-1, 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4. So both the digits are set separately because the quadrants 1, 2, 3, 4 are given for permanent dentition. Simultaneously, 5, 6, 7, 8 are for primary dentition. Then going on to the next system, that is Zsigmondy-Palmer. Here it is only denoted by the cross and which area the tooth number is given. So 1 to 8 are similar tooth numbers of central incisor, lateral incisor, canine, and so forth. And the quadrant is drawn to indicate which quadrant the tooth belongs to. The third system that we hardly use is the universal system, in which from the upper right side, number one starts to number the whole arch up to the opposite side, going on to the lower left quadrant and ending in the lower right quadrant with 32 number. Similarly, for a deciduous dentition, same upper right side, you start with a A and go round, then go down and end in the lower left side. Only it's alphabets instead of numbers. A family dentist, after completing restorative procedure on an 11-year-old patient who has moderate crowding of anterior teeth, observes a primary molar in various states of exfoliation. What is his advice to the patient? When should he return? So the answer is in 3 months observation. The patient should be observed every 3 months to see how his dentition is growing. The permanent teeth have all the following characteristics as compared to that of the deciduous teeth, except the answer is A, more prominent pulp horns. So when we had seen the differences in primary and permanent teeth, the permanent teeth had flatter pulp horns and the primary teeth had more higher pulp horns. At the age of 6 to 7 years in the primary dentition, the interdental spacing in the maxilla usually ranges from 0 to 10 mm. Sequence of eruption of primary teeth is ABDCE, so the answer is A. In the average child, teeth generally are in the process of calcification at birth. We've seen this primary and first permanent molars. The eruption of permanent teeth in cases of extreme early loss of primary teeth will result in eruption of permanent teeth. So what we had seen previously was the loss of incisors. Only incisors will not have any problem. But if you're talking about any primary teeth, there is going to be a delayed eruption in the permanent teeth. Prolonged retention of the primary teeth may cause. So if there is a prolonged retention of the primary teeth or a part of the primary tooth, that is maybe the roots, like mostly happens in the second mandibular molars, it causes disturbance in the path of eruption of the permanent teeth and it causes an ectopic eruption of the permanent teeth. That's why the second premolars are most ectopically erupted. Eruption of primary maxillary second molar before the maxillary second premolar is a sequence that the answer is D. Usually unusual and undesirable. The permanent maxillary second molar is not erupted before the premolar. So if this is done, then the premolar is definitely not going to have the space to erupt and it will get locked down. Eruption of permanent maxillary second molar before the maxillary second premolar is a sequence that is, again, unusual but desirable. So the maxillary, in the maxillary region, if the second molar is seen, it's unusual and undesirable. D, the answer is D. After eruption of the permanent tooth, the time required for complete formation of its root is approximately 2 to 3 years. Extraction of primary molars at 4 to 5 years of age delays eruption of premolars. Extraction of primary molars at 9 to 10 years of age also delays eruption of the premolars. So the first statement, like we have seen, is true. It delays the eruption. But post 7 years of age, if we remove the primary molars, then it accentuates the eruption. So 9 to 10, there will be an accentuated eruption. So the answer is C. The first statement is true. The second statement is false. Enamel rods in the gingival 1/3 of the primary molar, primary teeth are inclined. The answer is B, occlusally. So a clinical application of this is that because they are occlusally inclined, so we do not have to give a cervical bevel in this region because it is definitely not going to help us seal the restoration. Relative size of the pulp chamber in the crown in the permanent and deciduous teeth is smaller in the permanent teeth, smaller in the deciduous teeth. same in both? None of the above. The answer is A. They are flatter. So it is smaller in the permanent teeth. Incisal crowding may be assessed by interdental spacing intercanine with the labiolingual position of the incisor. The answer is D. All of the above. We can definitely see the interdental spacing, which gives us an idea of the crowding. The intercanine width also does, and the labiolingual position of the incisor, if there is some point of rotation, it definitely indicates crowding. So thank you so much for sitting through this lecture. That is all for today. I hope the concepts of development are definitely clear, starting from the previous lectures of embryology, going on to development of dentition, and now development of occlusion. So I have covered the MCQs of development of dentition and development of occlusion in today's lecture. And if you have any doubts, you can definitely write to us, contact us, leave a comment in the YouTube section. Do subscribe to us, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you so much.